Dr. Nick Delgado here with Dr. Terry Grossman. This segment, we're going to talk about sexual healing and sexual fatigue. And Dr. Grossman, those patients that come to your office, it's a major complaint, isn't it, in both men and women?
Yeah, I am absolutely shocked by how many of my patients complain of lack of sex drive, lack of sexual ability at ages beginning in their 20s. I mean, I have men with erectile difficulties in their 20s, and I have women with no sex drive in their 20s, which is, to me, shocking, because that's a time that really those levels should be at their peak, not to speak of individuals in their 50s and beyond.
So let's go through some really effective therapies that can start for, initially, let's talk about for men, because ED is a common problem, and when men feel that they cannot achieve or maintain an erection, they feel very challenged and intimidated by the whole situation. They even tend to avoid having sex with their significant other or wife, right?
It's life-ruining. I mean,
it is.
It's really a very serious and all-too-common problem that I'm not certain is related to environmental toxicity, because it's just so common today. I mean, I have patients in my clinic in their 90s that are sexually able, capable. And I have patients in my clinic in their 20s and 30s who are not. So I just have to believe that it's the exposure to these toxins early in life that has caused this epidemic.
So what would be the first intervention you would do, second or third? What are you looking to restore, to get that sexual energy, that zest back? And also, are there some complementary things, such as certain PDE5 inhibitors, nitric oxide, maybe Trimix if they need to go a little further, if they're having a lot of difficulty, if those fail? What does your bag of tricks include for helping men to feel and function as a man and have that feeling for sexuality that they really were born with?
Well, the two big sex-related complaints of males are lack of desire and lack of performance, and they're completely different. If a man doesn't have a healthy sex drive, they could care less about it. Then I think that really the trick is to optimize hormone levels. Look at their testosterone, look at their free testosterone, their free androgen index, and optimize that.
And can't estrogen interfere with the optimization or really take on the receptor sites or deplete the ability of testosterone to function properly?
Absolutely. It's a complicated matter that has to do with sex hormone binding globulin and many factors, but as part of a sexual history and a sexual workup, we measure those hormone levels and then optimize them as needed. And it's actually relatively easy to treat that problem with hormone therapies. Then the second problem is lack of performance, which is erectile dysfunction or inability to have an erection of sufficient quality to have intercourse on a regular basis. And this is amazingly common among men of all ages, certainly in my practice. So I think it simply is a matter of blood flow. For most men, in order to have an erection, you need to have an increased inflow of blood through the penile artery. That causes the corpus cavernosa, the spongy tissues of the penis, to enlarge. They then press against the veins in the wall, and then the blood can't get out, and therefore you have penile rigidity. So a secondary problem can be, as men get older, these veins get weak, the tissues, the tunic albuginea, gets a little weaker than it should be, and they have what's called a venous leak. So there, it can be a little bit complicated, but a competent sexual disease specialist or urologist can sort that out. For most men, it's lack of blood supply. Have you seen a cross-section of the penis to see what the size of the penile artery is? I did recently, okay. And I was absolutely shocked. So if we imagine that this is the corpus cavernosa on one side.
The cross-section.
The penile artery is this little tiny dot. I mean, wow. The coronary artery is about 7 or 8 millimeters in diameter. The penile artery is about 2 millimeters in diameter. It's tiny. It doesn't take a lot of atherosclerotic plaque to plug that up.
So that'll clog before they even have heart symptoms or heart problems. In fact, it's a forerunner to heart disease.
That's the current thinking, is that if a man has ED, he's at risk of cardiovascular, stroke, and other complications. Because the penile artery is so tiny, it doesn't take but a little bit of atherosclerosis to make that a significant problem. So one way to treat it pharmacologically, as you mentioned, is this group of drugs that were inadvertently discovered as failed blood pressure drugs, mm-hmm. called the PDE5 inhibitors, of which Viagra, Levitra, and Cialis are the main contenders. And for about 75% of men, they seem to work, or at least for a while. I have a lot of men in my practice. These drugs have been available for almost 20 years, and they worked for a while, but all the while, the disease is getting worse. You know, they're getting more atherosclerosis. Now these drugs don't work anymore. So for these men, we have to do something more powerful. And you had mentioned the injections. So you can take things, prostaglandin and some other medications, and they're just injected directly into the sidewall of the penis. It's not nearly as scary or painful as you might think, but it's not a perfect therapy. So we're looking for better options. Interestingly, some research out of Israel and elsewhere suggests that if you just do something where you take the wall of the penile shaft and you hit it with a what's called a shockwave machine, kind of, this is the type of device that was used to break up kidney stones. They would put a patient in a big bath and put these powerful shockwaves in, and you could break up kidney stones so they wouldn't have to go in with surgery, the baskets, and get them. If you do the shockwave therapy, this will release VEGF, vascular endothelial growth factor, and they can grow new blood vessels. In addition, we've been in our clinic working with PRP injections. So what I'll do is I'll do the shockwave treatment, and it's painless. 1,500 shocks are given to various areas. Then we'll use a vacuum device where we cause the man to have an erection, and we put a rubber band at the base of the penis to maintain the erection. And I wait 10 minutes. The reason I wait 10 minutes is because I want to create hypoxia. Hypoxia, lack of oxygen, mm-hmm. is a condition where the cells are starving for oxygen. So now when I inject the PRP in there, PRP is like a magnet for stem cells.
PRP stands for?
Platelet-rich plasma, just something we take from the bloodstream
and
of the patient.
Spin off the part of it and separate
collect
the
platelets, inject that in there, and it's honestly a far less painful injection than these these other injections.
And what size gauge needle? Because I know with the
30.
Or the Trimix, they use a 31 gauge, very thin,
very tiny needle.
So 30 is small also.
Yeah, very tiny needle.
It's like an insulin needle. It's very, very small.
30 by a half.
And it feels like a little pinch at most, right?
Most men don't complain about it. They complain when I do the training to teach men how to give themselves the injections with the Trimix, with the prostaglandin, that aches. They don't like it. But this PRP doesn't hurt.
When they first push it in, it feels a little achy. But depending on the mix, sometimes they have no ache if it's a good mix. If it's not a very good mix designed for that individual, then they feel achy during the entire erectile process.
Absolutely.
Right. So make sure you get a doctor that knows what Trimix is going to work for you.
Exactly. But the good news is these platelet injections don't hurt at all.
How often do you do the platelet injections?
My protocol at current is I do a series of six.
Okay.
Twice a week. So twice a week. A man will come in, we'll spend 15 minutes with a shockwave, about 30 minutes. So we do the rubber band thing to create the hypoxia. We put the injections in.
And the injections are near the base of the penis, kind of an angled similar
along
to where
the
you
side,
would do.
Along the side of the shaft, 1 cc on each direction.
Okay.
And then we leave the rubber band up for a number of minutes. And then we deflate everything, and the man goes along his way. And oh, by the way, one of the side effects that the guys are very happy about is they get increases in penile size.
Oh, wow.
They're much bigger terms of girth and in terms of length. So men are happy about both of these things.
Your patients think you're a hero.
When you have this problem, men will be very gratified to be able to restore their sexuality.
Amazing.
Now, it's not a perfect therapy. It doesn't work for everyone. But when it works, the men are extremely happy. It's not an expensive therapy. So I think we're moving towards turning ED into not a medically treatable disease, but some type of interventional disease where we have something that works for the overwhelming majority of men. We don't have all the answers yet. I'm thinking that maybe stem cell therapy will be better, but it remains to be seen. I'm not a research scientist. I just follow what, you know, the research people are doing. I keep track of the literature. If I see something better, we'll try that in the future. But right now we have something that's increasingly good. So I think for men, that problem is becoming increasingly solvable. For women, the main two problems with women are hypoactive sexual desire and dryness. Those two things really interfere with satisfying sex life for women.
I have a question to Dr. Grossman to add to the issue. It's been noted that when men have high prolactin levels, prolactin is almost like an estrogen-like hormone, that they tend to develop ED, and there's a medication that clears the prolactin, relatively speaking. But also, Dr. Ernest Winder stated years ago at the Pritikin Center that one of the leading causes of high prolactin was a high-fat American diet. And if they switched over to a whole foods diet without added oils, much like Caldwell Esselstyn advocates and I do in my book, Simply Healthy, and his Prevent Reverse Heart Disease, you accomplish two things. One, prevent reverse heart disease, you're reversing heart disease in the penis, which, as you stated, was a leading cause of erectile dysfunction. And two, you calm down or reduce that prolactin levels. And we've also learned, Ernest Winder stated this years ago, that prolactin was associated with a high rate of breast cancer. So within 30 days, he stated, you reduced your risk of breast cancer significantly. So with this intervention, as a practicing physician, you're one of the unique physicians that recognizes that diet, exercise, you mentioned shine in the earlier segment, but following these protocols, they all work synergistically to get a better outcome than if you just do a medical intervention. Is that true?
Absolutely, absolutely. And I think that for those individuals that can follow the Esselstyn-type diet, and honestly, a lot of people can't.
One that can.
Yeah, it's a difficult.
To me, it's life or death. If I don't do it, I realize my cholesterol goes up, my arteries clog. As I stick with it most of my lifetime, I've noticed tremendous benefits. And I noticed at the last conference, plant-based nutrition physicians, there were 600 physicians from the beginning of only 50 showing up to oil-free plant-based nutrition. So we're coming up with better recipes. So that's really the key is, like you said, can you follow it? Can it be practical? And there's options now.
It's becoming increasingly popular.
Yep.
I just had a conversation with a former employee of mine, and she was calling me to tell me she's built a new business where she is making freeze-dried Esselstyn-style meals.
Wow.
That she'll just provide people for lunches and suppers to last them a week at a time and just send them to them frozen. So something like that is becoming a lot easier to implement in your life because many of us are busy. We don't have this type of diet. It's not a grab and go. It takes a little bit more cooking and a little bit more processing, a little bit more shopping. So it's becoming increasingly easy for us to follow. But I absolutely concur with you about that, is that lifestyle approaches are fundamental.
Well, we have to make it more practical. I'm glad you brought it up because we're launching a Chef Roman type series of Simply Healthy Meals. Mm. And we have a professional cook who's going to help to implement. And we're literally weeks away from helping private individual clients and patients. But we're looking to the best method to make the tastiest menus, recipes, and then, you know, freeze them a la lean cuisine type, but without all the chemicals they use and all the sugar and the fat they use in those meals. Even those so-called diet, Weight Watcher, I hate to use names, but you look at the list of ingredients and the percentage of fat and sugar and protein, it's not much better than the typical fatty meal. It's just amazing to me that people need to recognize that whole food eating is more than just avoiding sugar or just avoiding wheat or something. It's become a science. We call it lifestyle medicine now.
Right. Well, I commend you for your efforts and sign me up as soon as possible.
You're in. I'm in too. Because I'm out there in the public. I travel and, you know, I bring my own food with me. I mean, I do certain things that are above and beyond. And I've noticed even in Wynn Hotel, they have vegetarian options. Down below in Venetian, they have juicing, you know, right there. You can pick
them
up.
There are people who say that you can reverse ED just by going on this type of low-fat animal-free diet.
I can tell you for a fact, because I go back 40 years with Nathan Pritikin, who started this whole movement, and we had a number of men. It usually took from 1 to 3 years, but they would get back to us and say absolutely their ED had reversed. So besides right. proof of reversal of cardiovascular disease, as Caldwell Esselstyn has proven with angiography in 16 patients or more, we had a number of men, that was the first thing they noticed and were thrilled about, because they couldn't really monitor their heart. You know, a doctor had to monitor that.
Right.
But their penis, it either worked or it didn't. And when it right. worked, wow, what was that? It was just diet and exercise and stress management.
Right, exactly. So I think that following that type of diet makes a lot of sense.
That is awesome. We're going to pause, and I'd like you to comment on this particular segment. Subscribe to our YouTube channel if you haven't already, and visit Dr. Terry Grossman's website. What is that website?
My website is grossmanwellness.com, one word. GROSSMAN. Wellness.com, one word.
And we have a special offer for you at bedroommastery.com. Check it out, a link of some really cool videos by some of the top physicians and female physicians talking about female libido. And that's going to be our next segment, so stay tuned.